So, sir, we are glad to have you here on CIIC Live. And, sir, as we know, you and your team are the pioneers of first ever Indian made computer chip Shakti. So, I would like to tell our viewers about the chip and how the journey of Shakti began and how things finally shaped up. So, shall we begin, sir?
Sure, go ahead.
Okay. So, it's over to Ankita now.
So, everyone who will be watching this, this is for you. So, what is Shakti? Shakti is India's first open source homegrown processor. And we will be asking, sir, a few questions and getting to know more about Shakti since it's one of our own and homemade. So, you'll get to know a lot about it and what India has to offer. So, sir, first question we would like to ask you is, when the Shakti project was started, how was your journey from then to now? And also, what kind of challenges did you face?
Okay, so to give a bit of a background, Shakti is part of Rice Labs processor development efforts, which have actually been going on for almost like 12 years or so. And the Shakti project, which started somewhere in the 2011-12 timeframe, was essentially to make our research efforts more formal and adoption of open ISA, which is the RISC-V. So Shakti, a lot of people think it's India's first processor, right? It's not. I mean, people like ISRO, DRDO have been developing processors. Shakti is India's first effort to develop an open source processor. It's also the first effort where a complete processor ecosystem is getting built instead of small disparate efforts. So what started as an effort to kind of consolidate our research efforts and also to get an open source ecosystem going so that it's just not IIT, but there is a processor development ecosystem around the country. So that has been the objective of the journey. And I think we have achieved that significantly, because if you take a look up where we were in 2012 and where we are in 2019, about 7 years, you have industry-grade lower-end processors. The higher-end processors will come soon in about a year, year and a half or so. They're open source. They're available to anybody. So anybody can buy an FPGA board, come to our website, Codeline, download it, start playing with it. Anybody from a professional to a college student or even a school student. So in that respect, I would call it democratizing processor development, right? It's as much a social cultural play as much as a technology play. So if you look at a lot of what we're doing in Shakti, with the processors by themselves are fairly state of the art and stuff, but are they dramatically different from existing processors? No, but what they are is they're open source. The tool chain is significantly open. The development methodology is open. So Shakti's primary impact is essentially democratization of processor development. Till now, processor development has been kind of stuck in esoteric enclaves inside fairly large MNCs and stuff, right? It was very closely guarded secrets. The development methodology, the testing methodology, the techniques, all of that were hidden. You'll get papers and stuff, but Intel or AMD or ARM will never tell you that how they optimized a floating point processor at a very fine point.
Okay, sir. Moving on to our next question. How many variants does it have? Would you be looking at multi-core implementation of Shakti chip anywhere like CIIC-LIVE or something?
Multi-core implementations have been developed and are being tested. Shakti basically is broadly 6 families of processors, right? So Shakti's ambition is probably the widest in the world. I don't think any other effort comes even remotely close. So if you look at the broad classes of Shakti processors, you have the E-class, which is the embedded one, which goes into anything from door locks to larger embedded controllers. So those are equivalent to kind of like a Cortex-M class, right? And then you have the Shakti C-class, which goes anywhere from 300, 500 megahertz all the way up to 1.5, maybe 2 gigahertz or so. So these are like Cortex A53, A55, A35, A7 class processor, which is roughly equivalent to what CIIC-LIVE and Berkeley call their rocket processors. Then you have the Shakti I, which will come out shortly, in about 2-3 months or so, you'll start seeing an alpha version, which is equivalent to what Berkeley call its boom processor, which is an out of order, which basically starts touching a Cortex A73 or a Core i3 class processor. So those are when you're starting to get into mobile, lower end desktop. Then you have the Shakti S, which basically is a server grade, which goes into completely into Xeon class territory. That's a derivative of the I-class, but it's aimed properly at server class processors rather than this. And then you have the Shakti H class, which we now call Parashakti, which basically looks at supercomputing class applications, both conventional supercomputing and AI/ML class supercomputing. So there you're talking 6,428 cores, AI/ML accelerators, and those kind of things. So these are the five general purpose variants. Then you have the special variants for Shakti fault tolerance. You would have seen the announcement between IIT Madras and Thales. Thales is one of the world's largest defense majors. They supply all the electronics, significant portion of the electronics in an Airbus. The Rafale fighter jets that India is buying is mostly Thales electronics and software. The Scorpion submarines we are buying. So they're a major Indian partner also. So Thales actually wants to use potentially Shakti fault tolerant variant. So they are essentially funding our R&D. The intellectual property actually comes from IIT Madras, right? It's not a collaboration in that respect. We're actually developing that, putting in open source. So these class of processors will now go into aerospace systems. It will go into autonomous cars. It will go into car control systems. We also have the Shakti T, which is a secure variant, which does everything from lower end security to higher end mill grade security. So if you look at it broadly, there are actually seven class of processors, five general purpose and two specialized. Added to that, you'll also get the AI machine learning type accelerators and so on.
Okay.
Just one second.
Yeah.
Yeah, go ahead.
Okay. So, sir, the next thing that we would like to ask you is that Shakti being India's first computer chip, do you think it's an arm killer?
No, see, the goals of Shakti are manifold, right? Is Shakti's capabilities matching what ARM delivers? Yes. Now, the way the team and the startups that follow business. See, we will talk about our strengths. We will never talk about, hey, we're going to replace ARM, we're going to replace Intel, we're going to replace AMD. That's left to the end consumer, right? So we will never criticize or badmouth any potential competitor or people in that space. We would like to talk about our strengths. Shakti's strengths are, it's probably the broadest range of open source processors in the world. Like I said, I don't think anybody comes close in terms of what we're imagining and what we're delivering. So everything that ARM has, at some point of time, we will have an equivalent. The market will make a decision based on the Shakti ecosystem and the startups that will come around the Shakti ecosystem as to whether it is a viable alternative to ARM. Now, it is not Shakti that's an alternative to ARM, it is the RISC-V ecosystem itself, right? There are equally credible players in the RISC-V space, including SciFi, the very first startup that came out of Berkeley. There is Andes from Taiwan. There are other players too, right? So, if you ask me, the RISC-V ecosystem, yes, it's a good alternative to ARM. I see ARM potentially losing market share if the RISC-V ecosystem evolves in a manner that suits commercial requirements. Right? So just developing intellectual property and having some cores and companies in a consortium is not enough to replace something like ARM. The whole ecosystem has to be built, but the ecosystem is getting built. So ARM will have a tough fight on its hand against RISC-V. But as to where the market goes, lots of factors come into play. People think technology is the only determinant factor. Technology and engineering probably accounts for 30%. 70% is marketing, alliances, a whole range of factors, right? But broadly, in the longer term, the RISC-V ecosystem will be significantly more comprehensive in the ecosystem, primarily because you will have
tons and tons of players providing cores, variants. So ARM cannot match RISC-V, primarily because RISC-V is open source, ARM is proprietary. It's interesting that MIPS has gone open source now, but that's rather late in the game, so I don't know how that's going to go play out.
So, sir, moving on to our next question. Yeah. So, you mentioned about Parashakti, right? So, what is the Parashakti project all about? And, sir, another thing, we are not going into any kind of criticism or anything, but, sir, how is Shakti at par with big names like Intel and any other big names? So, can you just brief us on that?
No. You're comparing apples to oranges, right? Shakti basically provides cores and intellectual property blocks. An Intel chip is a foundry plus the intellectual property blocks plus the ability to realize a particular intellectual property block on a piece of silicon, right? So when Shakti's first tape-out happened on Intel 22 nanometers, Intel put in a team of 6 to 8 engineers to help us take the Shakti code along with HCL backend engineers. See, typically when you do a chip, you have the logic design, which is kind of abstract. Then you map the logic design to silicon, which is called the backend process, right? So a logic gate is like an AND gate, right? If you add two numbers, then you have the logical AND of that. But how you realize that in silicon is an entirely different ballgame. Just because you can do this doesn't mean you can do that, right? So Shakti to transform into a set of processors which can match something that Intel gives or Qualcomm gives will involve multiple companies. The intellectual property that Shakti provides, that is the source code that Shakti provides, over a period of time will be on par with anything that Intel or ARM or AMD has. But that is only about, I would say, 30-35% of the equation. The rest 65% comes on how you realize on silicon, how you package it. There's a whole bunch of other things that comes. Intel has a lot of expertise. So that will be done by companies which use the Shakti intellectual property to realize chips. So Shakti does not immediately translate to a chip. There is at least 2 to 3 steps that is involved from taking a Shakti IP and also mixing and matching with other third-party blocks. Intel, for example, in its desktop chips has got great graphics coprocessors. Shakti is all about the computing core. We don't have any plans of graphics coprocessor. So somebody wants to compete with, say, Shakti on a desktop chip, they have to figure out where they will get the GPU from, right? So a lot of things are involved going from Shakti to that. Shakti basically, like I said, apart from democratizing the CPU development process, also wants to make sure that the core IP in a chip, which is the CPU blocks, the network interconnects inside the chip, the NOC, is available in open source. So that it levels the playing field for somebody to aspire to be the next Intel or the next Qualcomm and so on. So Shakti is a core building block, but by no means it's the only component of getting an Intel class chip.
Thank you, sir, for that brilliantly explained answer. Sir, now I would like to ask you a different kind of question from the rather core theoretical questions that we've been talking about. So now, sir, I would like to ask you that how do you think, what do you think about the fact that we are symbolized as a software nation but not a hardware nation?
Well, these are the choices that we made, right? I started my career with Hindustan Computers Limited. It's called HCL Tech now. HCL, Wipro, AKM, there are 4 or 5 companies actually building hardware back in the 80s. So we started as a hardware nation. Due to a variety of reasons, mostly commercial, we transformed from being a hardware nation into a software nation. That transformation, I think, was a mistake because it was easier to do services than products. Back in the mid-80s, late 80s, Indian mini computers were on par with the rest of the world. You could actually buy a computer in India, developed in India, which was on par with what Sun Microsystems or Hewlett-Packard gave at that time. A lot of companies, HCL, Wipro, decided that doing hardware was pretty tough, which was very valid because the government policies were not suitable at that time. I can't blame them. They had to make business decisions, right? I mean, they have shareholders to respond to. So due to a variety of circumstances, the transformation happened. redoing the transformation, I don't think is going to be difficult. It'll take time. The problem in doing the hardware is currently manufacturing of the hardware subcomponents is almost non-existent in India. We don't have foundries. We don't do LCD panels. We do some basic resistors and capacitors and so on. See, where China is successful is because the lower end ecosystem is there. But with mobile manufacturing happening here, and people like Foxconn bringing in the subcomponent vendors, hopefully that will change. But I think it's like about a 15-year period before we can aspire to where China is. We can do it. It's not a problem. It's really not that big a deal. But we have to get there.
Okay, sir. So I would like to ask you one last question. Sir, can you tell us about the five guru mantras of success? Any five that comes to your mind?
You don't need five mantras here. The key to engineering, right? I can talk only from an engineering perspective. The first is curiosity. Okay. You have to be really, 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 really curious. You talk to Neil, talk to anybody else in the team. It's an inherent curiosity that drives everybody. That has to be tied to passion also, right? You need to start with curiosity. If you're not curious, you can't be an engineer. You don't even attempt to do these things. Then you need the passion to go along with that. Along with the passion, engineering requires discipline. It's a curious mix. You should be curious up to a particular point. Once you make a call, you should reduce that curiosity and get focused on implementation, right? So Shakti is a classic example where we think big and implement small. We will claim we are the most comprehensive CPU processor family in the world. We will be. We will actually claim to reinvent some aspects of computing. It might sound like a lot of bragging, but it's justified by what we are doing. But at the same time, after saying that, we will get down to detail and sweat out the nuts and details, right? So discipline is needed. Engineering discipline is very, very key, which comes along with focus. And last but not the least, translate into products. You should decide what not to do. Product, you can't say arm is doing that, I'll do this. Arm is doing that, I'll do it. Right? Stop looking in a mirror, stop looking at your competitors. You fix it. Decide what you want to do. Stick to it like a guided missile, right? See, you can do all the thinking. You take opinions. You come to a logical conclusion, right? Logical, rational conclusion where you hear all the stakeholders. But once you decide to do something, stop second guessing yourself. It may be a mistake, it may not be a mistake. Once you decide to do something, get it done.
Okay, sir. So it was a wonderful experience, sir, interacting with you, and we really enjoyed it, and I hope our viewers enjoyed it as well. Sir, we are looking forward for more such meetings in the future, sir. Surely you do answer our questions.
Thank you. We wish all the best for Shakti, and we hope to see it there.
Okay. Thanks a lot. Appreciate it.
Thank you. Okay.